determinant of cells during development and thus affect their developmental fate. These are cytoplasmic segregation and induction. I ended the last lecture by describing experiments that demonstrate how cytoplasmic segregation establishes the fundamental asymmetry of an embryo through the differential distribution of cytoplasmic determinants in the blastomeres that result from early cleavage. Today, we're going to turn to the process of induction, in which the developmental fate of cells is determined by signals that they receive from the cells around them. Our discussion of induction will then lead us to begin to consider how the complex morphology of an organism emerges in development through a process called pattern formation. Now, in the later phases of development, and how late this is really depends on the particular species we're talking about, but later on, the fate of a cell depends more on its position in the embryo than on the nature of the cytoplasm that it happens to have acquired earlier through cleavage. The reason for this is because signals received from other cells become the dominant influence regulating gene expression. The importance of this process of induction in development actually was discovered long before cell signaling and gene expression were understood by a German biologist named Hans Spemann, who was working in the early part of the 20th century. Spemann was following in the tradition of experimental developmental biology that was established earlier by people like August Weismann, Willem Ruh, and Sven Horstadius, whose work we discussed in the last lecture. But Spemann took this work much farther. In fact, Spemann's considered by many to be the father of modern developmental biology. Spemann early on developed a technique whereby he could transplant pieces of tissue from one embryo into another. Now, this took a very practiced and steadied hand, but he was able to do this with embryos that were as small as still only being in the gastrulophase. Spemann used newts in many of his experiments. Now, newts are kinds of salamanders, and they're an interesting kind of organism to use for this work for two reasons. First, it's possible to graft the tissue of one species of newt onto another species of newt, and this is something that often doesn't happen. Second, and more importantly, the cells of different species of newts often differ in their pigmentation. That is, the cells of different species are different colors. And this was particularly useful because it allowed Spemann then to follow the developmental fate of the transplanted tissue because it looked different. He would put a piece of donor tissue of one color into a host gastrula of a species of another color, and he could tell where the cells had come from because of their color. Now, Spemann was interested originally in the problem of progressive determination. As I told you last time, determination occurs gradually as the fate of cells become progressively narrowed over the course of development. Thus, Spemann did experiments in which he would do things like transplant tissues coming from embryos of different ages into each other and ask how the fate of those tissues might be altered by the manipulation. For example, he might transplant a patch of tissue from a part of the gastrula that would normally become something we would call neural ectoderm. This is a region of tissue that will be associated with the eventual formation of the nervous system. And he'd take this patch of tissue from a place that would become neural ectoderm and transplant it into a different gastrula, into a place that would eventually become, say, epidermis, that is, the skin tissue. In this case, let's say, the epidermis associated with the belly of the animal. In other words, he's moving tissues around to see what would happen to their eventual fate. Now, one of Spemann's most important early findings was that if these kinds of transplants were done early enough, the transplanted piece of tissue would develop according to where it was transplanted, not according to where it came from. So to go back to that specific example I just mentioned, if Spemann took a piece of embryo from a region that was fated to become neural ectoderm and put it into a different embryo in a region that was fated to become epidermis, the transplanted tissue would become epidermis. It wouldn't remain neural ectoderm. This kind of result showed that the ultimate fate of the transplanted tissue had not been determined at the time the transplant was done, and would eventually become determined according to the cells it was in contact with. Now, the interesting thing was that Spemann would only get this result if the transplant was done early enough. If he performed these kinds of transplants later on in development, then the transplanted tissue would not change its developmental fate. In other words, in a later stage of development, a transplanted piece of neural ectoderm would turn into a small piece of nervous system tissue wherever it was put in the organism. Now, these kinds of experiments demonstrated two points. First, they showed that the fate of tissues is progressively determined. This isn't surprising to us because we've seen this sort of thing earlier when we were talking about how the blastomeres become progressively determined in the early phases of cleavage. Secondly, most important to our discussion now, this result showed that the fate of cells can be determined by the region in which they're located, presumably because they're receiving signals from the cells around them. Now, Spemann's most important experiment was done in 1924 in collaboration with a young student that had been working with him named Hilde Mangold. Hilde Mangold's PhD thesis was designed to look at how these kinds of transplant experiments affected tissues coming from actually a very particular region of the newt gastrula, a region called the dorsal lip of the blastopore. Now, recall from a couple of lectures ago that the blastopore of a gastrula is the opening to the primitive gut region, what we called the archenteron. The dorsal lip of the blastopore is just the name for the side of this structure that's on the side of the embryo that will eventually become the back or the dorsal surface. So it's just a particular piece of tissue. Now, the reason they were interested in this piece of tissue is that observational studies had suggested that this particular region appeared to have its developmental fate determined very, very early on, much earlier than the other tissues in the gastrula. So they wanted to know what was special about this particular kind of tissue, and that was going to be the project that Hilde Mangold did. Now, if the idea that this part of the tissue of the embryo of the gastrula was fated very early on was true, then what you'd predict is that if you did the same kind of transplant experiments that Spemann had done earlier with other ectodermal tissues, you wouldn't get the same kind of transformation. In other words, this dorsal lip of the blastopore wouldn't be transformed into some other tissue, even if you transplanted it very early on. And in fact, that's exactly what Mangold found. But that transplant experiment also yielded a very unexpected result. At the point where Mangold transplanted the dorsal lip tissue, she found that not only did that dorsal lip tissue develop into parts of a nervous system, as you would expect, because it was not changing its fate, but it actually induced the appearance of an entire second embryo attached to the first. In other words, it was as though this transplanted piece of tissue had taken over this region, caused another separate gastrulation event, a gastrulation event that created two embryos attached at their bellies with two separate back regions. Most importantly, this second embryo, the one that was created when this dorsal lip tissue was transplanted, was composed not only of the tissues that had been transplanted, that is the donor tissues, but also composed of cells that had come from the original host. Thus, the transplanted cells had somehow altered the developmental fate of the cells around them, just the opposite of what Spemann had seen in his earlier work. So Mangold's work here was important for two reasons. First, it provided, again, a very dramatic example about how cells in one tissue can develop or can affect the developmental fate of the cells around them. Spemann eventually was the person who coined the term induction to describe this phenomenon. Second, this result illustrated that there appears to be particular regions in a developing embryo that play a disproportionately important role in organizing the development of tissues around them. In other words, some tissues are somehow able to control the regions around them more than you would expect from the work that Spemann had done earlier. Not all induction involves this kind of very special organization, such as was originally described by Mangold's work. But since Mangold made this discovery, many other kinds of special regions that seem to play an important role in organizing the tissues around them have been discovered. Spemann eventually went on to coin the name organizer to talk about these kinds of very specific regions. These organizers essentially are acting like foremen or crew leaders in development, taking a leading role in determining the developmental fate of the tissues around them. So if they're transplanted someplace else, they're not influenced by the cells that they find themselves now located around. Just the opposite happens. They take control. Now, there are a couple of interesting footnotes to make about the work of Spemann and Mangold here. The first concerns Hilda Mangold herself. By all accounts, Mangold was a brilliant student destined to become as famous and as productive as her advisor Spemann. Certainly, most or all of the actual work of what is called in textbooks the Spemann-Mangold experiment was actually done by Mangold. Unfortunately, Mangold met with a very tragic end. She was killed in an accident when she was 26 years old, just before her doctoral dissertation was published, when a gasoline heater in her kitchen exploded. By some accounts, Mangold's PhD thesis is considered to be one of the few that could have deserved a Nobel Prize on its own. As it turns out, Spemann continued working on these kinds of problems, and eventually he received the Nobel Prize in the 1930s for his work on developmental mechanisms, about a decade after Mangold had died. Now, the second interesting footnote here concerns the molecular mechanism by which the organizer that Mangold and Spemann discovered works. Undoubtedly, induction by the dorsal lip organizer must involve one or more molecular signals produced by the cells of this organizer, which influence the behavior of the cells around them that they contact. What's particularly interesting about this case is that fully 8 decades after Mangold originally described the dorsal lip organizer, researchers are only now beginning to identify the particular molecular signals involved. And the answer still isn't fully understood. This lack of progress is not for a want of trying. People have been working on this problem for many, many years. But it illustrates instead how hard it is to pin down the exact mechanism involved in such a complex system. Now, to help us understand the role of induction in embryonic development, let me give you another example of how this process contributes to the development of a complex structure. This example involves the development of the lens of the vertebrate eye. The lens, of course, is a very specialized differentiated tissue, specialized to transmit and focus light. Ultimately, at the end point of development, the cells in the lens literally fill up with a protein called crystallin. This is a protein that makes these cells hard and transparent, which is, of course, necessary for their function. The lens of the vertebrate eye develops from ectodermal tissue, the ectodermal layer of those 3 embryonic layers we described earlier. This is the same germ layer that gives rise to skin, hair, and so forth. And the question is, how does a particular patch of ectoderm on the outside of the developing organism become fated to turn into something as specific as a lens? Now, in a frog embryo, to take an example of an organism where this work has been done, there's a region in the head, or in the developing head, a region that will develop into the nervous system that we call the forebrain. Now, the forebrain develops from an invagination of neural ectoderm that had formed the neural tube, and this only happens at the head, what will become the head end of the animal. Now, this neural ectodermal tissue bulges out by morphogenetic mechanisms, such as we described earlier, so that the sides begin to form little bulges that we call optic vesicles on the outside of the neural ectoderm. These optic vesicles are called this because eventually they'll form the part of the nervous system that becomes associated with the eye, including the retina, as I'll point out in a second. Now, these optic vesicles expand until they come in contact with the ectodermal cells that are now the ectodermal cells on the outside of the embryo. And here's the point. When the optic vesicles come in contact with the undifferentiated outside ectoderm, the region where this contact is made begins to thicken, begins to form what is called a lens placode, and the cells in the lens placode are what then become the precursor to the formation of the lens itself. The idea then is it's the expansion of this piece of neural ectoderm, the optic vesicle, that is inducing the outside ectoderm to transform itself into lens tissue. In fact, you can demonstrate that this kind of induction occurs in a couple of ways. For example, if you take an embryo and dissect out the growing optic vesicle, so there's no optic vesicle at all, then no eye will develop, no lens will develop, I should say. In fact, even more cleverly, you can go into the developing embryo and put, say, a very thin sheet of plastic or a layer of cellophane in between the outgrowing optic vesicle and the outer ectoderm so that the optic vesicle is still there and grows out, but you now have a barrier. And if that happens again, the ectoderm will not differentiate into a lens placode and eventually a lens. Now, there's another point to be made from this example, and that is that induction also or often involves sequences of reciprocal interactions among different tissues in developing organism. These reciprocal interactions contribute to tissues differentiating in the correct position and at the correct time. So, for example, it turns out that once the lens has differentiated, the lens itself now becomes an inducer, and the lens then induces the optic vesicle to further differentiate and form the retina. In fact, the lens also will send out signals that cause other ectodermal tissues to differentiate and become the cornea. This makes sense, because where the lens forms depends on where the optic vesicle happens to grow out. So the optic vesicle signals to the lens and says essentially, form a lens here, signals to the ectoderm and says form a lens here. Once the lens is formed in a particular position, the lens signals back and essentially says, okay, I'm here now, I need a retina on this side and I need a cornea on the other. So these kinds of inductive mechanisms allow the precise positioning and timing of these complex developmental structures. Well, the differentiation of cells into functionally different cell types is really only one part of what's needed to build the complex structure of a multicellular organism. Consider another kind of structure. For example, consider a cat. I have a cat. If you look at this cat, it has a number of limbs. And I want you to think now about, say, the limbs in the front of this cat, the forelimbs, versus the limbs in the back of this cat. These limbs are very different structures. The way that the forelimbs are put together are very different from the way the hind limbs are put together. But they're essentially made out of the same thing. They're made out of bone and muscle and tendon and skin. So what's different between these kinds of structures is not the kinds of cells in them, but the specific arrangement of those cells into different kinds of structures, different shapes of bones, different positions of muscles. So the question I want to turn to now is how do morphological differences like these come about in development? And this is where the process of what we call pattern formation occurs. Pattern formation is the development of spatial organization of the parts of animals with organs and tissues occurring all in the right in their normal places relative to each other. Not surprisingly, pattern formation we would expect to involve molecular signaling among tissues, and thus a kind of induction, just as we discussed. But the examples we've looked at so far, the Mangold and Spemann work and the example of the lens development, actually all involved direct contact between different tissues, the tissues that were interacting. As we'll see in pattern formation, other kinds of signals can spread widely through a developing organism. They diffuse across tissues, and in so doing, they set up gradients of signals in those tissues. And these gradients can provide developing cells with information about their relative position in an embryo. So we sometimes call these kinds of cues positional signals. Let me make this point clear with a specific example involving the development of the morphology of a vertebrate limb. But let's not talk about cats. Instead, let's talk about bird wings, specifically the wing of a developing chick. Now, vertebrate limbs and chicken wings all begin as undifferentiated, what we call limb buds. Limb buds are really small expansions of tissue that stick off the main axis of the trunk of a developing embryo early on. A limb bud starts out as a layer of ectodermal tissue with a core of mesodermal tissue, all undifferentiated other than being specified as ectodermal and mesodermal. Now, At the end point of limb development, each bone and muscle and every component of the structure of the wing, in their correct three-dimensional arrangement, has to arise from this lump of relatively undifferentiated tissue. How does that occur? Well, the answer appears to be that there are that the embryonic tissues in the wing bud somehow are receiving positional information that indicate what part of the limb that they should turn into, depending on where they're located, from particular groups of cells that are sending out signals that allow this location to be determined. Now, let me give you some examples. I want to give you a model for how this worked. There's still quite a bit of work being done on the development of vertebrate limbs and chicken wings, and so some of these answers are changing daily, but I want to give you a current model. One model suggests that there are particular regions of developing limbs, like chicken wings, that act as organizers, similar to the kind of organizer that Spemann and Mangold described. But these organizers are secreting diffusible molecular signals that move throughout the tissue of the limb, of the developing limb. Let's take a bit of a closer look to see how this is thought to work. First, we need to get our bearings for a second, a couple of axes that we need to sort of describe so that you get an idea of how the orientation of a wing occurs. There's really three axes to consider. One axis is that goes from the fingertips to the shoulder, or from the wingtip into the body of the animal. We call this the proximal to distal axis, with the distal end being the farthest. If you consider your hand as a model, this would be your fingertips, and the proximal end being the closest, the part that's closest to your shoulder. Again, now I'm thinking about the hand and arm that we have as an analogy to the wing that a bird has. So this is the proximal distal axis. The second axis we need to think about is that one that would go from, if we're thinking about the hand, from your thumb on the top, if you're holding your hand out to the side, down to the little finger on the bottom. This we would call the anterior to posterior axis. And this is actually the same head-to-tail axis that we talked about earlier when we talked about the head-to-tail axis defined in gastrulation. Now, finally, the third axis that we need to think about is the one that goes from the back of your hand to the front of your hand, and we call this the dorsal to ventral axis. Now, the point of these axes is that they describe the three dimensions that the developing limb, in the case we'll discuss, the developing wing, has to work with. Okay, so let's get back to the problem of wing development in chicks. The differentiation of digits along the proximal to distal axis, that is, the axis that goes from the wing tip into the body, appears to be controlled by an organizer region that's located at the outermost tip of the wing bud as it's developing. This region of the wing bud at the tip is called the apical ectodermal ridge, or I'll call it AER for short, because that's easier to say. Now, the AER secretes a number of proteins that diffuse through the rest of the limb bud that appear to act as growth factors. By this, I mean these proteins induce the continued outgrowth of the tissues of the limb by causing cells to divide more. You can demonstrate a number of interesting things about the way the AER works by the same kinds of experiments that Spemann and Mangold had done, or other experimental developmental biology biologists, largely dissecting out or transplanting pieces of tissue. For example, if you dissect out the AER, the limb stops growing. If you transplant the AER somewhere else along the body, a limb will begin to be induced there. So this suggests that the AER is responsible for the outgrowth of the limb. Even more significantly, though, if you remove the AER at different times, imagine that you're removing the AER at different points during which the limb is developing, you don't simply get smaller limbs. It isn't as though if you remove it halfway through limb development, you get half of a wing. Instead, you get limbs that only have the most distal parts missing. In other words, the parts that are farther out. It's as though as the AER is growing out at the tip of this developing limb, it is laying down some pattern that says essentially put the close material here, put the middle materials, the middle structures here, and then finally put the farthest out structures here. If you remove the AER somewhere in the middle, all you get are the structures associated with where it should have been, where it has been up to that point. This finding suggests that the AER produces some kind of molecular signal that helps specify position along this distal to proximal axis, or prostal to distal, proximal to distal as it's growing out. Now, actually, the AER doesn't appear to be working alone, but instead works in conjunction with another kind of organizing region located immediately beneath it in the mesoderm that's called the progress zone. And this has gotten to be a complex story because it seems as though the AER and the progress zone are sending signals to each other. And it's the progress zone that's essentially specifying the way that tissues will differentiate as the limb grows out. Now, a second major limb bud organizer region described in chick wings, one that's better understood, is called the zone of polarizing activity, called the ZPA for short. The ZPA is located near the base of the limb bud, in other words, near the body on the posterior side. So again, if we're thinking of our hand, it would be in close towards your body and on the surface that would be associated with your little finger. Now, chickens don't have fingers, of course, nor birds in general. But if you look at the structure of the bones of their wings, they actually have bones that are asymmetric along the anterior to posterior axis, such as our finger bones are, with the anterior-most bones being more thumb-like and the posterior-most bones being longer and finger-like. So there's an asymmetry in the bones that are being grown here. It turns out that the ZPA is thought to be responsible for producing a molecular signal that induces the bones of the wing along this anterior to posterior axis to differentiate in the proper way. So, for example, if you take a ZPA out of one chick embryo, again, it would be located at the posterior side of the base of the limb bud, and transplant it into another chick embryo, but now put it on the anterior side. So you are adding a second ZPA to another developing limb bud. What you see is the development of a wing that has a double set of digits. This double set of digits has finger-like digits both on the posterior and on the anterior aspect. This would be as though you had a hand that was joined together at the thumbs with the fingers both on the up and the down side. The interpretation of this result is that the zone of polarizing activity is sending out a diffusible signal, this diffusible signal creating a gradient from where it's located at posterior end, where there's a high concentration of this chemical that tails off as you go more anterior. And that it's the concentration of the chemical produced by the zone of polarizing activity that determines whether structures fated to become bones will turn into more finger-like structures or more thumb-like structures. If there's a high concentration of this substance, you get a more finger-like structure. If there's a low concentration, as you'd expect on the more anterior side, you get a thumb-like structure. If you transplant a zone of polarizing activity over onto the wrong side, you now have two sources of this chemical, and you have two high concentrations. And so you would get finger-like digits occurring both on the anterior and the posterior surface. Well, these kinds of signals that are coming from organizing regions like the AER or the zone of polarizing activity are thought to create essentially a three-dimensional network of concentrations in developing tissues. The concentrations basically being a way that a cell can read where it is in that structure, and those concentrations then going on to determining what that cell will actually eventually differentiate into. You can imagine this is not a very difficult system to conceptualize because you can imagine concentration gradients going in all of the relevant axes. But of course, it's a long way to get from these concentration gradients changing the fate of particular cells to the structure of something as complicated as the bones of our fingers or the bones of chicken wings. Even in a model system that's as well studied as wing development in chicks, there's an enormous amount we still have to learn. But nonetheless, it's clear that pattern formation involves cells receiving and responding to these kinds of signals from areas of tissue that act as signal beacons. Now, in our next lecture, we're going to conclude our discussion of development by looking at a specific example of how positional cues like this operate to control gene expression and thus to determine the developmental fate of the cells and tissues that are responding to these signals.